webinar, How to Change the World with an Empty Email Inbox, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. Thank you for taking the time to join us today. My name is Sarah Hay, Assistant Director of Alumni Career Services, and our presenter today is Rich Tafel, Founder and CEO of Public Squared. Today's webinar has been very well received by our alumni community. We were excited to actually break a record with this one, and we had almost 900 folks register, and currently we have 160 people on the line. So thank you all for joining us. Before I turn it over to Rich, I'd just like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded, and you can access the replay of this webinar within 3 business days on our YouTube channel. To access, simply go to youtube.com and search Georgetown Alumni Career Services on the channel side, or you can just click on the link that I sent out to everyone in the chat area. There are 2 audio options. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial in to the conference bridge number provided. Participants are not required to have a headset, but you are welcome to use one. It is important to note if you experience audio difficulties while listening via your computer speakers, this can be caused by having multiple software applications open. So feel free to close some of these applications or simply join us via the conference bridge number provided in your reminder email. Questions are welcome. Please type in your questions in the question area on your GoToWebinar control panel screen. And Rich is planning to answer as many questions as time will allow during the end of the presentation for Q&A. And afterwards, I will email everyone a copy of his slides. You can absolutely view them later. If you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area if possible. And without further ado, I'd like to tell you a bit more about Rich. Rich is the founder of Public Squared, where he works with other world-changing leaders to make real their vision of social justice. He has provided successful strategy to the most challenging issues of our day. An ordained minister who first worked at Harvard's Chapel, he went on to work as Director of Adolescent Health in MA. And in 1993, he opened the offices of Log Cabin Republicans in Washington, D.C., bridging the gap between conservative Americans and the LGBT community. During that period, he created 50 local chapters and engaged in the highest level issues of LGBT and AIDS community. In 2002, he launched his own strategy company and worked on the AIDS relief program for Africa. In addition, he worked with USAID on programs in Brazil, Mexico, and Jamaica. Based in Washington, D.C., he's worked with the nation's leading social entrepreneurs in the U.S. to gain funding and change policy. In addition, he's the Chief Strategy Officer of the Workplace Wellness Council of Mexico. This past year, he's provided the strategy for Michigan to launch the nation's first statewide social entrepreneur program. He focuses his coaching practice on world-changing leaders at their startup phase. He's currently working with BigThink.com to develop a citizens training program to transform American democracy. An author, this past year he won a prize for a spiritual fiction book proposal. He writes a blog for Stanford Social Innovation Review, and he does end each day with an empty email box, even though we can clearly see he's a busy man. So Rich, thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. I do know that we are both interested in just asking everyone a quick question. We would like to know how many emails are in your inbox at the end of each day, and then I will finally let Rich take over. All right, I'll give everyone a couple more seconds. Almost everyone's voted. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and close it out. All right, so 51% of people on the line have under 100 emails in their inbox, so that's good. 23% are under 500. 5% under 900, and 21% over 900. So Rich, I'll finally hand it over to you. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks so much, Sarah. I really appreciate being on here, and I want to thank John Kaiser for introducing us and making this possible as well. Yes, I'm excited to cover a lot of turf today, and I really think what we just heard was really important, that this will be a recording. You can look at this anytime and feel free to go back and watch it. So I'll be moving through a lot of content quickly, and my goal is to dedicate time at the end for questions. So let's take a look at what we're trying to accomplish here. We're going to change the world and have an empty email box. So I just wanted to do a quick overview. We just did the poll. We've done a little bit of introduction. I'm going to talk about the connection of values and time management. I'm going to help us get clear on purpose and values and the importance of that. Then talk about getting clear on goals and how that leads to your to-do list, then how we can plot them into our schedule, then how we can have the infamous empty email box. I'm going to throw in a few productivity tips for everybody, and then I'm hoping to dedicate about 15 minutes at the end here for questions. So let's get started. A lot to cover. So the problem, as I see it, is that we lack simple and practical steps to plan our lives in a meaningful way so that we can live to our greatest purpose and potential. Now, I want to share just quickly about my week. You heard about my biography, but most of my clients start by saying, Rich, you don't understand. You're just not as busy as I am. I'm really busy. So I think we're all busy. I'm just going to quickly, and I work on policy. I do strategy and coaching for about 15 clients. As you heard, I do the Wellness Council in Mexico. I just led the first social entrepreneur contest in Michigan. I serve a number of boards. This is a chapel in Los Angeles that I serve on, Wayfarers Chapel. And my hobby is I do family videos. I've got a large family, and I produce about 6 movies each year for the family. I share that because I'm busy, and so are you, and we're all very busy. So this is not a contest about who is more busy or who is less busy. I think we're all juggling a lot of stuff. And the secret is trying to figure out how we can manage that. And the facts really back this up. We're in a really unprecedented period in the history of the world. Eric Schmidt's quote that every 48 hours, people now produce as much content as mankind did from the dawn of time until 2003. We are in a whole new world. And we often refer to this period as the information age. And I would really argue for that we are out of the information age. We are in the aggregation age. That means that we are no longer just getting information. We are now blocking information as fast as we possibly can. And we're trying to figure out what information is important and what is not important. And we're all finding our way. I think one reason why there was so much interest in this particular topic is this is a new area for all of us. We're all trying to figure it out. And if your goal is to change the world and do good in the world, and you can't execute, it's not very effective. Now, we all have the same amount of hours in a week. So when we say, I'm busier than you, or they're busier than I am, or I'm more busy, we all have the same amount of hours in a week. We have 168 hours. The issue isn't that we don't have time. We all have the same amount of time. The issue is that we either are successfully or unsuccessfully prioritizing that time. So next time someone says to you, do you have time for that, you might say, actually, I can't prioritize that. So let's keep calm and let's prioritize. It will be a big theme of what we're trying to do today. So for me, working with my clients, I find that vision without execution is as meaningless as getting things done with no purpose. I had some clients who come in with this amazing world-changing vision, and yet they have no way to implement it in their week, in their month, in their year. So that means that vision never gets done. It's never going to happen. The flip side is I have some great task managers, but they're disconnected to any purpose or value or meaning in their life, and that can feel equally meaningless. The secret, I believe, for time management is to marry your values to your daily schedule in your email box, in your activities in your life. So in today's call, I'm going to talk about the goals of getting clear where we're going, getting clear what's important to us getting there, prioritizing those things that are important, systematize our life to get it done, and then change the world for the better. Here's my busy schedule, your busy schedule, our busy week. I believe we need to get clarity on our purpose, our values, our goals, and then our systems to accomplish it. Again, marrying these two things together, both our purpose and our systems. I love this quote from Alice in Wonderland, where she's meeting the Cheshire Cat. And she says, would you tell me, please, which way I ought to go from here? And the cat says, well, that depends a good deal on where you want to go. And she says, I don't much care where. And the cat responds, and it doesn't matter which way you go. And then she responds, so long as I get somewhere. And he says, oh, you're sure to do that to the cat if you walk long enough. Well, if we don't know where we're going, we're sure to get somewhere, but we have no idea where we're going. That's where most time management fails. We don't have a North Star or anything that's guiding us toward what we're getting to. So we get a lot done, but we feel somewhat unfulfilled. For me, I encourage everybody to get clear on what their purpose is. So I'm going to put one of my biases out there. I believe that we all have a purpose. I guess that could be a radical statement. But I think we all have a purpose, and I think we actually getting clear on what that is, or even closer to what that is, can completely change how we act out in our life and what we accomplish and prioritize. If we know our purpose, we'll prioritize things that will lead us toward that. Now, this is a good book by a guy named Tim Kelly. It's called True Purpose. He's got some great exercises for you to engage in if you'd like to figure it out. The thrust of the book is that we do know it. We do know that answer of what our purpose is, and there's reasons why we're not telling ourselves. I thought it was a very clever book, and these are really practical strategies. But getting clear on your purpose, to me, is the most important place to start any kind of time management program. Then we want to get our values. These are the principles that are going to lead us in guiding our life. So what I would suggest as another exercise, if you're not clear on your values, and most of us are not, is just to take time with a friend or yourself or a coach and brainstorm about 20 of your key values out. So when you do it, I've got up here health, family, friends, love, honesty, integrity, truth, faith, security, work. I've done this with hundreds of clients all over the world, and I've got some good news. Humanity has pretty much the same values. I'd say there's probably roughly about 12 I've seen almost consistently with everybody I've worked with. And then we're all different, and we all have certain different ones or different ways of expressing it. Brainstorm 20. The most surprising ones for me that I've heard in my coaching career have been golf as a value and pets as a big value. But brainstorm about 20 and then keep about 6. And when you have those 6 values, then I want you to look at your schedule. Because in your schedule is what you are actually valuing. So you might have written down values you think you hold in your head and you kind of think you believe in, but when you look at your schedule, that's what you really value. So things will pop up in your schedule that you'll have forgotten to add to your value list. And then look at your credit card or checkbook or your bank account. Where you spend your time and where you spend your money is probably the best indicator of what you truly value. Not what you say you value, but what you truly value. So now that you've looked at them, you'll get a sense of what's really going on. And then I want you to write your values out. So for me, one of my values is health. I would write, I am healthy. Okay. Taking that value, turn that value into at least 1 or 2 actionable steps that will turn that value into reality. So using this example of the value, I am healthy, how would I turn that into something tangible in the real world? I walk 1 hour a day. That becomes a value-based goal. When you write out these goals, you probably have heard this expression of SMART goals: specific, measurable, achievable, realistic, and timely. The main thing about the goal is make it time-specific. So where does this value exist? Very common with my clients that when they articulate a very powerful value, they then say it's impossible to make it tangible. You cannot make honesty into anything active in my life. And so I would argue just the opposite. If you can't figure out how to make it tangible, it's probably not something you're living out in your life. So figure out a way to make your values tangible goals that we can write out in a very timely manner. It can be a little challenging at first, taking what seems abstract, making it tangible. But until we put our values into our schedule, they're not real. We come to the to-do list, things we need to get done. So then we plot our goals, the things we're trying to accomplish, into a to-do list. Now, I'm suggesting now we've added some value-based goals into the to-do list. These are the really important things that we find most valuable in our lives. Very often they're the things that are not in our to-do list and they're not in our schedule. So I really want to make a concerted effort to get these into your to-do list. What you're going to find, every one of you on this call has some sort of list, either written, handwritten, in your head, of things you need to get done. So those things that you need to get done are very often projects for work or life maintenance goals or a variety of other things. So there's a lot of competition. I strongly recommend writing them down. I know a lot of people say it doesn't matter if you use online, but I do believe programs like this one here, Toodle-Do, is a fantastic program for organizing your tasks. What I like about it is that it has an app for your phone. It is a task you use in your computer. And it's something that if you're thinking about something on the fly, you can type it into your phone. If it's something before bed and you're not going to sleep well until you write it down, you can put it into your to-do list. But one of my suggestions is to ruthlessly use to-do lists. So in this list, you can organize it by, if it's top, the highest priority, lowest. And you can, I would say I work my to-do list about 6 or 7 times a day, certainly in the morning when I'm starting. And I only put things in the top level, that top level you're looking at, that I want to get done that day. You'll notice on the software that I could put in folders and goals and due dates. But I strongly suggest that we try to keep this as simple as possible, because if your time management system becomes too complicated, you'll abandon it. So you put the things you need to get done that day at the top of the list, and that becomes a goal like an email box. It's something we want to clean out by the end of the day. And it becomes a negotiation with yourself. What you're going to find with your to-do list is that we are all unrealistic about what we think we can get done. And so this list is going to create an honest contract with ourselves about what we say we'll get done at least today, and then prioritizing the rest of the list later. When you're sitting in the doctor's office or in line somewhere, or you're stuck in traffic, and you're not driving, hopefully, you could just check your to-do list and kind of reorganize it and play with it and gamify it a little bit. And then through the day, you'll see I've knocked out one of the top goals for that day. And the point really is, you want to end the day with a completely cleaned out top of your to-do list. You can decide how to organize this any way you want, but I'm just going to suggest best practices that will work with my clients. But it does become a little bit of a game and a contract with yourself. So now we've gone from our purpose and our values, and we've turned the values into goals. Our goals are on our to-do list. So now to make these real, we've got to put them into a schedule. And I'm going to introduce a concept about scheduling that I will bet most of you have never heard, and that is that you need to spend as much time in preparation as you do in engagement. So what do I mean by that? I'm going to give you a week here, a mock week. But if you look at it, the items that are in orange are things that I would be doing with myself, or inner goals, things, and a lot of values goals, things I need to accomplish. But they're not engaging with clients, they're not engaging with the world. I really encourage you, to the extent that you can do it, to block out your engagement time into solid blocks of time, and block out your personal time into solid blocks of time. The real shocker here for people is you'll see that I spend probably more time in preparation or practice than I do actually engaging. For me, that's all part of what my clients are paying me for. They're paying me to be balanced. They're paying me to be thoughtful. They're paying for me to have read a great book. They're paying for me to be happy and value-driven. So in a way, when I'm engaging, I'm bringing all that to the engagement time. But those are almost like performing times or engagement times. Block them out. When you mix this all up and you do a meeting with somebody, then you try to go back and say, do meditation, and then you're going to check your emails, then you're jumping into lunch. It's a haphazard way to really treat yourself. Breaking it in to a weekly structure. Now, my life, because I'm on retainer with a variety of different people all the time, means that I will have fire drills every week. My life will be chaotic, guaranteed. The more chaotic your schedule, the more you need systems, so you don't have to think about what you're doing. This is roughly what every week looks like in some way, shape, or form. You're looking at that week, you'll see I've got journaling and meditation in the morning. Those are aligned to my values. And I know that if I don't do them before breakfast, they will never get done. I've proven that to myself. I've got cardio in there. I think if I don't take care of my body, I can't do the rest of the stuff that I need to do if I'm not healthy. You also see I'll start the week with an administration time. I'll end the week with me marketing and administration time. And then you'll see also in that week that I'll have 3 times blocked out for emails. And put in time for meals. And if I have to walk to meals, I include that into the schedule too. Really going to encourage you to try to plot your days and your weeks into your schedule. In the beginning, what you'll learn is that you are delusional. you have no idea how much time things take. And only you'll begin to contract with yourself as you keep a schedule and realize that it takes more time to do everything than we like to think. So then you can see you might create an administration day. Those things that we try to squeeze in between things, I would say put them front and center. They are part of life. Getting your hair cut, going to the doctor, getting the car inspected, whatever those little details are, blot them into your schedule. Don't think you're going to sneak them in the middle of other times. They are a force to themselves. Also, if you do it, for example, on a Monday and you deal with your administrative stuff, you can actually enjoy your Saturdays and Sundays as downtime. You're not thinking Sunday night, oh crap, Monday morning's coming and I'm already stressed out. That means you're already bleeding into the next day. So make that day a day to focus on your planning and structure for your week, day, and month. And there might be engagement days. For me, it would be working with clients, doing a workshop like this, or leading a workshop or speaking somewhere. But again, if I lose balance and I stop with meditation or I stop with cardio and I stop journaling, I stop organizing, I will become hectic, frantic, and chaotic. All right, so that gives a sense of how we plotted we went with purpose, we took it to values, we set some goals, the goals went into a to-do list, the to-do list went into a schedule that we check daily and weekly, and now email. Email for most time management courses is taught as a necessary evil, a pain in the ass, something very negative. I love email. I think it's really one of the most effective ways to manage my life and communications with a lot of people that I could never have done 20 years ago. So I think it's a real blessing. Now the trick is figuring how to make it work for you. So again, I mentioned that we use our to-do list as a bit of a game. I call it the empty email box game. I want to make this a fun experience. It's pretty simple. Everything should be pretty simple in this process. So let's talk about what that looks like. When you start, for me, I need to do it in the morning because I might have fires to put out. I might have crises or emergencies. So I need to check it relatively early. You'll notice I do it after my meditation time or sometimes my gym time, my breakfast. If I don't, I can get pulled into email very dramatically. So, but I do know I have a contract with myself. Rich, we will check emails at this time. Promise. I'll go do these other things. So I come to the email box in the morning. I read my email box. I respond to everything as much as you possibly can. Then you can delete a lot of emails. And then I want you, once you've read it and responded, file or archive it. Some people like to keep elaborate file systems. I think that's too much work. I use Gmail. I can search for things if I need them. So I'm not a big fan of tons of files. Keep it simple. Then there's some things you're going to want to postpone in your email box and put off for later. It's going to take more thought, a lot more reading. So one lesson about the things that you're postponing, do not be the postponed email in someone else's email box. Do not write a novel to people. They will not read it. They'll postpone too. So keep your email to others short as well. Your goal in the morning is to bring that list down. You're probably not going to eliminate it, but you want to keep your email list down. At midday, we're going to do the same thing all over again. You read them, you respond, you delete, archive. And now you work on some of the postponed things for morning, and you might still be postponing some stuff. And later in the day, we have a contract with ourselves that we're going to come back to email before we close out the day. And then in the evening, we're responding, deleting, archiving. And then, if there are postpones that are really important, move them to your to-do list. It means they require a lot more time than just email. They're a project. But I can promise you, many of the things that you postpone are things you'll never get to. So if you can have an honest conversation with yourself about some of the things that you say you're going to read or you're going to look at, right now you can save yourself a lot of time. Otherwise, they'll end up on the to-do list and slowly drop to the bottom. But this is a system for responding. So then at the end of the day, you do want an empty email box. You want it all cleaned out. So what are some tips for using email that I found? Get real. You're not going to read that. So just tell yourself you're not going to read that. People keep saving things they said they're going to get to and they never do. Start having an honest conversation with yourself about what you can and cannot get to. We just learned that we're overwhelmed in this aggregation age, but it really requires an honest conversation. Unsubscribe to newsletters, journals, and things that you think you should be reading. and you know you don't. And again, it's about getting real, but keep your email box kind of sacred and protected and really clean it out. There's a lot of junk that you're letting into your email box. Unsubscribe. Take the time to unsubscribe. Just don't delete. Unsubscribe. We don't want it back in. When you respond to people, keep it simple. Email allows that. Not be rude, but if someone asks, I have people who write me a novel and I can respond with the word yes, do it. When you're writing to people and you're talking about setting something up, you can include all the possible information they'll need in the first email. The time, the place, the name of the restaurant, where you're meeting, what your phone number is, what your Skype address is, whatever it is, put it all in there in the first email so you don't have to have 15 email exchanges about one meeting. Now this is interesting, slowing down conversations. The faster you are at speeding up and cleaning out your email box, you will find people who will want to hold a conversation with you via email, and they'll never stop. So sometimes you don't really need to get right back to them. This is interesting. So you might just slow down conversations by moving them to a to-do list and saying, I don't need to get back to them, because if I get back to them, they will have no choice but to respond back to me again. And this conversation is not really proving productive for both of us. Try to move people who text you and callers to email. Email is a much more efficient system. Texting has become definitely the way that millennials are communicating right now, but a lot is getting lost. A study just came out this last week that said millennials are actually having shorter memory and attention span than their grandparents. And the reason is we're living this very fast-moving world. Email actually might sound old-fashioned already, but it's a way to systematize. You can archive and go back to an email and check it. It's very much harder with texting. Texting gets lost. In callers, we spend way too much time on the phone when we call. People waste time on calls, so try to drive them to email as well and make calls very special. Drive all your email accounts to one instead of looking through a bunch of them. Just drive it into one. There are ways to do that. Turn off alerts. A lot of people use alerts of email, so during the day it will pop up on their screen that so-and-so, or they'll flash on the screen that an email came in. This will drive you crazy. You see, if you make a contract with yourself that you will check emails, you can be calm and cool, and now you'll get back to people. But if you're constantly reacting, that means you're never in the present. You can't focus on what you're doing now. Gamify. This should be fun. Getting an empty email box should be something that is fun and you can celebrate at the end of the day. My clients call me and say, zero emails, and they're really excited. Make it fun. If it's not fun, you're not going to do it. And when you do get that empty email box at the end of the day, celebrate. I think the benefits of this are that you get a sense of accomplishment. You're clear for the next day. People spent hours going through yesterday's email, figuring out what they didn't or did not read. You're responsive to others. Huge time savings from constantly looking through old emails. And of course, now we're ready to change the world. I want to throw some productivity tips at you as well that I thought would be very helpful. And these are just sort of random things that I've learned to manage time. I'm a big fan of scanning all your paper and backing it up on your computer, marrying up the folders that you have on your computer desktop with the folders that you have on your laptop and phone and with your bookmarks on your computer, so you're very systematized. And then back that all up. Get rid of paper. Share your documents with yourself. A lot of us use multiple vehicles, phones, iPads, laptops. If you use Dropbox or Google Drive, you can keep a very active folder system. So the things that you're working on now, have it shared constantly with yourself. You can also do that with teams. Set bookmark reading time. One of the biggest challenges for most of my clients is they do what I call bookmark swinging. They go to one, then to the other, then to the other, and the whole afternoon is lost kind of in an internet world. So when you see a bookmark you find it interesting, you kind of want to read it more, or you want to follow that link, set time aside and say, I'm going to read all the bookmarks in that time. What you'll find is actually they won't seem so important later, for one thing. And two, again, you're making a contract with yourself that you will do it. You'll get to it, and you're actually putting it in your schedule to do it. But you're not going to do it in a reactive way. This guy is managing his bookmarks. So everybody says we shouldn't multitask, that we shouldn't do it. I'm a big fan of multitasking. And what I mean by that is Imagine that one of my goals is I like reading books. I also have to go grocery shopping today, and I need cardio. What if I pick the grocery store that's a couple miles away, I walk to it, and I turn a book on tape on audible.com on, I'm getting cardio, I'm going shopping, and I'm listening to the book that I want to listen to. Make it fun, make it interesting, but we can multitask. The multitasking we want to avoid, and frankly, if you follow the system, you'll never do, is holding a screen in front of someone's face when you're talking to them. It's the rudest thing you can possibly do, is be looking at a friend or a loved one and be staring at a screen. That multitasking, I'm not in favor of. But being clever how you combine your goals into one is multitasking we should look at. Stop bad meetings. I'm a big fan of this organization, the Collaborative Operating System, who really teaches you how to manage successful meetings. I think some of the greatest waste of time are really poorly run meetings, and they're really an energy sap. If you're in an organization, get a facilitator, get trained in a way to run meetings that are effective. Finally, don't cheat your health. People constantly tell me and brag how little sleep they get. I'm not impressed. I need 8 hours. I know that's more than most people, but if you're going to cheat yourself, you're going to lose. And then people say, oh, I'm sick and I'm out of work for 2 weeks, and then everything's lost. So that's a reactive, chaotic lifestyle, and we're living in a very sleep-deprived culture right now. So I'm going to say the one thing I would really focus on your schedule is having your weekends off as much as possible, and then finding that sleep time and prioritizing that over everything else. Okay, we've covered a lot of turf. I'm going to try to get – I really want to get some questions, and we're actually making good time, but I want to leave as much time for questions. So what we've covered on this call today was, first, getting clear on our purpose. If we don't know why we're going there, there's no purpose in going there. And everything's just a hodgepodge. So get clear on why you're here. What's your North Star? What is guiding you? What do you want people to be saying at your eulogy that you accomplished in your life? Get clear on your purpose. Otherwise, you're just managing shares on Titanic. Then you get clear on the values. These are the principles that are going to guide your life. You're going to map those out, and you're going to then take them and prioritize them and find out what are the key ones that are really you need to guide your life. Then you're going to put those into goals and mastering them in a to-do list. The to-do list then is plotted into your schedule, and you manage your to-do list and your schedule on a daily basis each day. Once you get these systems in place, it's a very short amount of time, I'd say 15 minutes or so, but once you get the systems in place, starting every day by thinking about how you have to do this is a waste of time. And then finally, the email. I'm a fan of email. I think it's great. I don't curse it. It's a wonderful way of communicating. But let's keep it empty and let's keep responsive. Overall, you've heard me say a number of times, gamify it, but I really think making this experience fun for you and for others is really the way to go. And then when we've accomplished that, we really can change the world. We can really think in dramatically big terms about really big issues that need to be changed. And we can have the confidence that we will have a plan that we can execute to actually make that change real. It's not theoretical. It doesn't live in our heads. Then we have hopefully a clean desk by the end of the week. And this is my email address. If you want to email me and just tell me you're on the Georgetown webinar, I'd be happy to schedule a half-hour coaching call if you're interested in doing a free coaching call. If you're interested in coaching, or if you want me to come and do a workshop or give a speech or a training, I'm happy to do all that stuff. I love doing all that. So but just please contact me at this email address. And if you do it, it would be helpful if you did it this week because I'll try to commit to all the Georgetown participants in the month of August and get that done in August. So I'd love to help you. Now, I know I covered a lot of turf on this call, and I purposely wanted to get as much information to you as fast as possible, knowing that you can watch this as a video over and over many times. And I also wanted to leave time for a little give and take questions. Usually, if I'm speaking or facilitating, I love interaction. It's a little tougher with a call with a lot of people. But I want to open it to questions. And what I would request, if you're thinking of a question, is it would be helpful to the call if you would ask a question that wasn't specifically completely about you. In other words, it would have group interest, something a little bit more broad than, this is my problem, how can I do it? try to think in terms of the group so that others listening to it will find value in your question as well. So if you have a question like that, that would be a good question. This is probably a good time to shift over from my talking and moving toward questions.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you, Rich. We certainly do have some questions here, but everyone feel free to type in whatever you'd like to ask right now. We do still have 25 minutes. And again, this is recorded, and I will send everyone a copy of the slides. So, Rich, do you mind just summing up one more time? We have some people who would like you to, again, summarize your list of steps on how to actually go leave here and tackle your inbox.
Yeah, let's go back to that. Let's go back to the email box. That's what we really, that was in the title of our program. So I'm using a program called Prezi, and I really recommend it over PowerPoint. It's a lot more visually interesting. I'm actually going to go right back to the slide so I can show it. It's basically these simple things when you're going through your email box. For me, I have a lot of emails because of what I do. I probably have more emails than most people. So I need to do it 3 times a day. You may be able to do it less. But I'm suggesting that you go through emails and read them in chronological order. Don't get into an elaborate system about thinking too much about what I have to respond to. Just go through them and promise yourself, I'm going to move through these, and I'm going to make a decision on each one. I'm either going to respond, yes, I can make the meeting, and then, boom, I file that. I personally think I like to file and archive emails and not delete them because I may need to refer back to it. And frankly, I'm so old that I often forget things. And I'm like, oh, where did I say it was going? Oh, I didn't put that in my schedule. So I like that ability to go back and check and file and archive. So you respond. Now, some things you can just delete. If it's this newsletter that you keep getting that you can't stand and you don't know why you have it, please take the time this week to unsubscribe from it. I know sometimes they make that a hassle, but we don't want anything coming into your email box that's not useful. But then some things you can just quickly read and delete. You'll never have to look at it again. Those are your options. Then you're going to have things throughout the day that you're going to have to postpone. It's either going to require too much thought, someone's asking you a lot of questions, it's a proposal and you need to get back to the proposal. That is not really something for email time. That's a project. That has to go back into your schedule. So if at the end of the day, you've gone through this 3 times, right? You've read, you've responded, you've archived, you've deleted, but there's still things that exist in your email box that will frankly haunt you if they stay in there day after day after day after day, make that a to-do. I need to respond to Bob's proposal. I'm going to put that into my schedule. I can even respond to Bob, I need to study this, and I will get back to you on this date. So that you don't have to actually respond in detail, but you can say you're working on it. It's very polite. The other thing is, some people write such lengthy emails that I don't really know what they want. You can actually coach them by writing back, this is a lot of information. What's the most interesting, or what's the question you're asking me here? And you'll find that forces some people to write back one line. I need to know if you can come to the meeting. Okay, I can respond to that. I couldn't get that in your email. So you might have to coach people. But those would be the steps that I'm suggesting. 3 times a day, read, respond, delete or archive, move on. Try not to postpone, but if you have things, you have to postpone. And finally, at the end of the day, if it's a real postpone, that means it's a project. Move it into your to-do list, and then, as we saw, your to-do list then becomes into your schedule.
Okay. So we have some great questions here. One person says, your tips are great and seem manageable once you have the system in place. Do you have tips on how to get from unmanageable, 3,000 emails in your inbox, to zero, which seems overwhelming? And, if you're on the road or in meetings all day one day, how do you play catch up?
Great question. So one is, I think one question is, I'm just overwhelmed. I've got thousands, and I do have many clients who start with thousands of emails. So we're doing a reboot, right, of your life. And I'm not a fan of what's called email bankruptcy. A lot of people, a lot of coaches teach email bankruptcy. You just do one email to everybody and say, I'm deleting this account, and I recommend that you give me this email or something. To me, that's a little bit outside integrity. I'm not a big fan of it, but, you know, whatever works for you. I personally, what I would do is say, I am going to get integrity with my email box. This is going to be a big shift. Getting through 3,000 emails is going to require a Thursday and a Friday. I'm blocking that out. I don't have a Thursday and a Friday for 2 weeks. I'm going to block out in 2 weeks a Thursday and a Friday, and I'm going to go through. And don't go through any sophisticated process to go through that 3,000. Start with the oldest and just action them. And by the time that you're done with the 3,000, you're going to be really ruthless at actioning. Boom. And it just get back. You're going to find invitations that you missed, birthday parties you missed, dinners that you missed. It's going to be a real education. But I think just moving through it very quickly, there'll be a lot of deleting at 3,000. One of the advantages of 3,000 is that so many things have already happened that you missed that you can kind of move through pretty quickly. So that's how I would deal with 3,000. You're rebooting yourself. You're moving into a new thing. You're going to have to plot that into your schedule to make that the value. If you're saying, I'm going to be responsible with email, then that value would need to be a goal. I'm going to dedicate time to clean my box out, and then I'm going to actually put it into my schedule. Second question that was asked was about travel time. And first of all, I would say get real about travel time. I travel to Mexico quite a bit and Michigan quite a bit lately, and I do a lot of traveling. And so the bottom line is that you are going to lose time. Come to that reality. No, you're not going to read 4 books on the plane. No, you're not going to read all these documents on the plane or at the airport. For all these promises that you're making to yourself, travels for me is chaotic. It's hectic. I need to sleep more when I travel because it's travel times. So the bottom line is be kind to yourself when you're traveling. And as far as email, you're going to have to block out time. But even saying to somebody, look, for me, hey, I'm in Mexico today. I'm not going to have a lot of time to focus on this. This is really important. Can I talk about it next week? Can you email me next week on it? If not, move ahead with whatever you need to do. This is just where I am. People are like, oh, okay, I get it. But just you might have to move through a little bit more delicately and just be honest. The number one thing about time management is we are delusional with ourselves. We are constantly in a conversation. There's a voice in our head that says we can get this all done, and another voice of reality that says, no, it's not going to happen. The one that says, no, it's not going to happen is generally more accurate. So listen to that when you travel and don't burden yourself. Block out time. And no, I'm going to be traveling that week. I'm going to be able to check email once, maybe, or I'm in a meeting all that day. That means I might have to do it 4 times on the next day. But it's, again, this is you're making a contract with yourself, and you're being strategic, and you're being proactive about your life. I hope that answers the question about travel.
Okay. All right, that's great. And we have another participant who is in a corporate culture in which work is not designed the way that, you know, you're able to lay out your week. But this person is in a position to change that. So how would you suggest having her start to make that change in the corporate environment?
Well, I've worked with a lot of businesses, and this same thing. A business can operate a lot like a person in that we can say, what do we value as the business? What do we need to get done? Let's be very respectful of people's time. Let's block out time that we're going to engage. Like you saw in my schedule, engagement time. But let's let people do what they need to do alone when they need to be alone. I'm a big fan personally in the corporate world of trusting people to work from home, on the road. I don't think it all has to happen in one place. So but getting clear, organizations absolutely need to say, you know, this is our mission and these are our values. And then this is how we act it out in our daily life. Studies show that unfortunately, the businesses and companies that have the best mission statements very often have the worst experience for their employees in the workplace. What's happened is they've spent a lot of money on a great mission statement. They hang in the lobby of the company, but it's never put into people's schedule. So what you put into your, again, your checkbook and your schedule is what the company values. So if the company says they value talent, pay your talent. If you say you value people's time, then don't make them work late. Incorporating your values and being crystal clear with it. I mentioned that collaborative operating system as a way to run good meetings. they're just a good, they have some good tips there about creating agreements with employees too. This is how we are going to operate. This is when you can contact me. This is how you cannot contact me. This is the best way I like to do it. And creating learning agreements between employees. But systematizing and with radical inclusion of your employees. In other words, not a top-down, hey gang, we came up with a model, and here's how we're going to operate. And you're going to really like it, because we're really going to be inclusive. Engage people. Find out what works. Bring the team in on it. Tell them what your goal is and why you're doing it. You will be a very popular boss if you treat people this way, because the hierarchy in corporate America is really brutal, the way it treats people. And it turns people into victims about their time. They always say to me, oh, Rich, you don't understand. I work for a company and I don't control anything. That's not true. That's a limiting belief, but it's a very powerful one because the hierarchy has told them, you know, you're going to fit into this schedule and be crazy and work long hours, and we're going to pay you to do that. So I think you could really do a lot of proactive creative activity as a boss. What an exciting opportunity. I hope you really run with it.
And Rich, on the other side of things, we have someone who's wondering how, you know, they aren't in the leadership role, but they would personally like to try and create more flexibility in their day while still seeming available to everyone else that isn't trying out this method. Do you have tips for someone who's just personally going to execute the plan?
It's trickier. The people who have least control, in my experience, of their time are generally younger people because they are, unfortunately, suffering from the burdens of a generation that doesn't really know how to manage time very often. So it is tougher because their bosses often operate in a hierarchical way. The secret I would suggest, and it's a good, you know, become a strategist yourself. Present to your boss win-win situations. What do they care about and what you care about? And present your changes in a way that's going to produce what the senior management is also concerned about. I think you'll be surprised. I've done this with a number. I've worked with a lot of millennials, and they've been very successful at teaching their bosses other systems. The boss gets what they want. Usually it's more productivity. And then the millennial gets what they want, the younger person, which is life balance, feeling better about your life. The other factor I would say is that the younger generation is transforming the workplace already, and it's rejecting the workplace. The average stay at a company is about 2 years for people under 30. So they're bouncing around. Corporations are desperate to figure out how to stop that, and they're losing a lot of money. With every time one of those folks leaves, it's a lot of money lost. So presenting it that way, too, look, if you gave us this kind of balance and we could do that, and I could accomplish the goals you want me to, but this is how I'd like to structure it, and I think you'll be able to retain us longer, that might be another strategy that I've seen work as well. But you do have to be very clever working from what could be perceived as powerless. If you come in and say, maybe we should do a training on the collaborative operating system, or maybe we should get coaches, and they do it, you'll be seen as a strategist, a young strategist that brought them a new product that they didn't know about that helps everybody.
All right, wonderful. And how do you manage last-minute fires without totally derailing your to-do list or schedule? You know, you mentioned, you know, your clients could have a fire drill at any moment.
Exactly. So, first of all, again, this is a really important principle. The more chaotic your life is or your job, mine is very chaotic, the more systematized you are. Now, people, I'm very calm, and I'm calm during my day, and people interpret that as I'm not busy. It's kind of funny. And so a lot of people act crazy and disorganized, thinking that shows that they're busy. They brag about it. I live in Washington, D.C., and people brag to me all the time how exhausted they are, and they don't sleep, and they're busy. So the first thing I'm going to suggest is be systematized. If you live in that, you know, fire engine life like I do, you've got to have systems. And then when you have the systems, you have an agreement with yourself. You're going to keep hearing me say this, but we have a conversation going on in our mind all the time with a variety of voices. Have a conversation with yourself that says this: we have really got it down. We've got a great day, we've got a great week plan, and a great month plan. We also know that there will be explosions along the way. And you will have to react. I will lose a whole day to a crisis. And when that happens, we are ready because we had the zero email box going into that day, and we didn't know what was going to happen, and we know we're going to make it up the next day. But it's just an agreement that is going to happen. In my life, there will be fire drills. There will be explosions. What's truly amazing, though, is to the extent that you're organized, people will conform to the buckets that you put them in your schedule. If you are not organized, you will respond reactively to other people's schedule and feel like you're spinning all the time. So the more organized you are, the more you can prepare for fire drills. But understand, it's sort of like travel. No, you're not going to make up a lot of work when you travel. You're going to lose time. Travel is going to be a little bit exhausting. And so let's just be honest about that. Second thing, when we have a fire drill, it's going to throw our schedule off. We're ready for it. And then in a really strange way, it's kind of exciting when we have fire drills because we know we can react very quickly. We respond to the crisis. We're ready. And then we know that we can get through it. It's not going to completely derail us. We expect it.
All right. And what organizational tools, including software, personal planners, calendars, and all that, do you personally use? And do you recommend any particularly useful ones?
Yeah, I try to, in my presentation, so when you watch it again, I try to actually, like I talked about Gmail that I use. I talked about Toodle-Doo. As a to-do list, a lot. I'm using Gmail and the Google Calendar.
How do you link Toodle-Do with your Outlook or Gmail calendar? Sorry, can you also mention that?
Sure. Yeah, and I'll just wrap up by saying we love tools. Okay, we love tools, and we have an obsession around technology. And I'm going to really just push back on that and say, if you're not getting the purpose and the value stuff clear, the tools will never work. The tools are a cruel trick that we're obsessed with. And that's the number one question people ask me is what tools I use. Technology, I'll use the newest technology. Everything I have is the newest technology because it speeds me up. But if I didn't have that other stuff, I couldn't do it. So I just want to make that really clear. And so, yeah, if you look through, you'll see I'm using a lot of the collaborative operating system, Tim Kelly's Toodle-Do, Gmail. So I just wanted to make clear, I purposely put the products that I use into the Prezi. So your next question was?
How you link Toodle-Do with your Outlook or Gmail inbox.
It's not linked. And I'm sure there are ways to do it, but it's just very simple. I use that. If I get an email that I need to respond to, I cut and paste it into my to-do list, but it's not linked at all.
All right, great. And I really like this next question. Do you have tips on crafting email messages that are to the point and don't waste others' time?
Absolutely. In fact, believe it or not, in my coaching practice, a big chunk of my time is writing emails for clients for two reasons. Why? We need to boil down what we're saying. Get to the point. For God's sakes, nobody can read. People are going to dedicate about 30 seconds to your email. If you end up in their postpone list and they don't have a system, you're not going to get a response. So one is just be very brief. What do you want? Email allows it. Now you notice I mentioned do not share negative information over email. I've discovered that email amplifies negativity. And it can seem a little abrupt and rude. And I get teased sometimes by how my friends call it haiku. I just say, yes, I can. Also, if someone writes you a long email and they've got 20 questions in the paragraphs, you write at the top of the email, responses below, you write your initial, and you just say, boom, I say RT, yes. This, no. I'm not clear on this. And now I've only had to spend a few minutes. They've done all the work of writing it all out. Also, I coach people to write me back what they really wanted. And this isn't exactly the question, but one other thing. If you're trying to get a meeting with someone or accomplish something with someone that you don't know through email, add value to their life. Do not make a request. So I wanted to share this with you. I want to update you on this. I thought this would be very helpful, and do you have time? And then when you ask to do a meeting, name specific times and dates. Believe it or not, when you say, I'd love to meet for lunch, for some people that is such an overwhelming question because they don't know when, so they cannot respond. But when you say, I'd like to meet lunch next Thursday, they'll very often say, I can't Thursday, but I could do it the following week. So helping the person on the other side be able to respond quickly. And knowing that they're only spending about 15 to 30 seconds on that email, let's keep it a tight conversation and let's keep it moving.
Okay. And Rich, we have some questions about when you check your email during the day. I know we saw your schedule. It looks like you block specific times. So the rest of the day, or do you shut off your email so that you just don't look at it?
Okay. I don't have to shut it off. I do block out certain times of the day to do it. And it gets back to this idea of, so you can see I'm on the schedule, I'm doing it three times a day. I turn the alarms off. Please turn the alarms off that are telling you emails are coming in, and turn off the noises on your phone, and turn off all the noises. Because if I am focusing on my administration or my client engagement, I cannot be interrupted. It's incredibly rude, and there we cannot multitask. So these are very disruptive ways. Yes, alerts about your schedule to remind you that something's going on your schedule, that's fine. Let's shut off the email alerts. I don't need to turn my email off or anything like that because I know I'm going to check it later. It's an agreement. I'm promising myself that we're going to have a zero email box. We do that every day. We know we're going to do that. So it's not a crisis. Again, moving your life from being proactive, values-driven, goal-driven, from a reactive, where really the tail ends up wagging the dog, is really what I'm trying to move towards. So for me, it's three times a day. Some people like to do it first thing in the morning. This is all very personal. It doesn't work for me because I won't do some of the more important values work that I need to do if I start going into emails and my mind shifts. But some people can do that. Some people do it four times. Some people do it once a day. Just really depends on what your traffic is. But, yeah, don't look at it in those other times because be present in the moment that you're in. And then when you're in email, this will sound strange, be present with email because you're in that moment and you've made an agreement to be here and you're honoring your email box. But when you're with a friend, do not pull up the screen in front of them and talking to them, start checking your emails in front of their face. It's incredibly rude. So it's all about making agreements about time and what works for you. For me, it's three times a day.
Okay. And going back to meetings, when another person is part of the decision-making process, what do you find is the best way to get things done? Is it daily or weekly meetings? Or any other advice for getting rid of bad meetings?
Great question. So meetings are really one of the time vampires of all time.
And I like that, time vampire.
They really are. They will just suck the blood out of you. And so one of the most painful things that my clients talk about are these meetings. So the truth is nobody likes them, and they very often are scheduled. So even asking does it need to be daily or weekly or monthly, I would say let the meeting schedule depend on what the purpose is and what the goal is. And we all make an agreement. But in a collaborative manner, in my experience, when I facilitate meetings, to be honest, people love my meetings because it's so respectful of their time. We're going to get everything done in the meeting. And when you do that, people actually look forward to meetings. It's very purposeful. But scheduling meetings for the sake of scheduling meetings is a disaster. Don't do it. So agree that even on this call, for example, I told you what I thought the problem was. I gave you an outline of how much time I'd spend on each one. Put that much prep into a meeting. If you start really prepping meetings the same way you prep your schedule, that your engagement time is equal to the time of preparation, you're going to have less meetings because people don't want to prep. They want to show up and kind of free associate for an hour and then create action steps that they will then discuss at the next meeting. So that's a waste of everybody's time. Again, we're shifting from reactive to proactive. If you take that course with Collaborative Operating System, that's been my favorite that's really transformed my facilitating ability. You'll see the difference. And you'll volunteer to run the meetings, even if you're a junior staffer, and the people who you work for will think, oh my gosh, they're brilliant. Yeah, you can run the next meeting. And it will be worth it because you won't be in those vampire meetings that just suck all the energy out of everybody. So I guess what I was saying is you might decide to do it biweekly, daily, monthly, but let it be purpose-driven. We're doing this for this goal, and this is why we're doing it, and this is the problem we're going to solve in this meeting, and here are the action steps we've summed up at the end. We're not going to meet again until those are met and accomplished. That's, organizing it through a system is the best way to deal with meetings. But they are probably the biggest time suck that I know in all of business.
All right. Well, Rich, thank you so much. We are actually at time. So we really thank you for all these helpful tips today. One last closing question. Do you have any tips on how, with this crazy schedule, how you stay energized each day?
My background, that you heard, was spirituality. So for me, it's being aligned to my purpose. It's meditation, prayer. If I lose that, I lose my energy. I work with world-changing leaders. I work with people who are trying to do good every day, and they inspire me. So I'm surrounded by good people who are trying to do good. And so those are kind of my secrets. If I miss cardio and gym time, I find it affects my mood. If I lose sleep, it affects my mood. So all those things contribute to really keeping you up and excited and looking forward to the day.
All right. Well, thank you so much. This is great. And thank you, everyone, for joining us. Again, you can check out Rich's presentation on YouTube. I'm sure you'll want to view it again. And I will send everyone a copy of the slides. Please check out the rest of our August and September webinar schedule. We have a lot of sessions coming up. And I hope everyone has a great day.